In 1982, EMBL, having just started the EMBL data library, actually advertised for a computer programmer, Greg Hamm, who was the then head of the EMBL data library. And I applied for the job, never having studied biology in my life. But there were a couple of things that were going on. I had actually worked in data provision and of social and economic data with large government surveys, providing them to academic scientists. And so I had a background in data provision. And also Greg at that stage, believe it or not, all of the programming in the data library was done in Pascal. And I had just become an enthusiastic Pascal programmer. So it was kind of, that fitted well. So I started as a computer programmer and quickly became a general dog's body. And then, eventually, when Greg left in 86, took over the leadership of the data library, and then on to the proposals for the EBI and eventually the launch of the EBI.
In my gap year between ending my secondary school and before I went to university, I went to Cold Spring Harbor in America. And there I worked in a wet lab, but there was some computational stuff to do and nobody else was around. So I taught myself how to do this and I enjoyed it, and actually also published two papers at the time. And so that was my first taster. I totally fell in love with it then. And I continued all the way through my graduate career, and now I'm clearly, all I do is bioinformatics.
Well, I got into bioinformatics before the word bioinformatics was really coined. I was a biology student in Heidelberg, an undergrad student, and once I saw at a blackboard a piece of paper where EMBL Heidelberg, the data library at EMBL Heidelberg, was looking for a biology student to work on a new project. And it sounded like a perfect description of me. They looked for a biologist with really good biology knowledge, very good command of English, and excellent computer skills. So I had never seen a computer before. English was my worst language in school. And I had so far already successfully achieved 2 years of biology study. So I thought, that's me, I apply. I was bold enough and I was the only one who applied. So they had no chance then to hire me. There was an additional hurdle in the interview, and that was Graham Cameron. So he asked me a lot of questions and I must have nodded always at the right place because I didn't understand a word of his Scottish accent. But I believe it was a mixture of my charm and that I'm the only applicant.
In a sense, I think that it was fairly obvious to me when I started with EMBL that this was going to be very important. It was clearly underlying information in living systems, and the rate of advance of knowledge was enormous. And so I immediately started getting ambitious and writing proposals for the EBI. In fact, I think in the mid-80s I started with Patricia Kahn, who was working with me at the time, writing sort of proposals for the EBI. And we batted this around, and there were various drafts of proposals. It got more and more serious. There were committee meetings, proposals were presented to council. And then in 1992, council eventually realized, I think, that if they didn't say yes to this EBI idea, we're going to keep bringing it back to them. So they said yes in 92, and in 93 they decided to locate it here in the UK on this campus. And I came then to the EBI as the first employee. I came across from Germany to establish the EBI. None of the buildings, the new buildings that you see here, were here at that time. The hall was a wreck. There was a horrible old building out here that was the EBI. In porta cabins at that time, and things have gone on since then. The knowledge and the information that's collected by the EBI and its global collaborators is so fundamental to the understanding of living systems now that actually you couldn't name a breakthrough that's occurred in the last 15 years that wasn't in some way dependent on the information of the EBI. That's how you do this science. The science wouldn't proceed without access to all of this information.
The EBI has been involved with all of molecular biology, sometimes in a very small way, and sometimes in a much more extensive way. Every time anybody searches DNA or protein databases, they are doing that at some level. They're either doing it explicitly at the EBI, but even if they're doing it somewhere else, they're doing it on the data sets that the EBI has helped capture and store and transmit.
I hope that a lot of experiments were successfully designed thanks to the EBI, thanks to the data we are providing, thanks to the tools we give. I don't think that there is a single breakthrough, although a lot of people at EBI were involved in successful projects like various genome projects, various functional genomics projects. But I believe it's more this underpinning role in across board in a lot of life science areas that's a real success story of EBI.
The biggest challenge that faces the EBI is actually a function of the fact that this is a new kind of requirement in science. What's happened in biology is that the information infrastructure is crucial to all of biology. And in fact, science funding hasn't had a sensible mechanism for funding it. That's not any criticism of anyone. It was just that that's the way it happened, that this new thing came along. And so what's had to happen is that research funding has had to be diverted to carry out this infrastructural activity. And that has made it very challenging because we're effectively pitched in competition with our customers, with the very scientists we're trying to serve for funding. And that has meant that, building a coherent and solid structure of funding to render the thing secure has been challenging. That has, I should say, moved on a lot in the recent decade or so, that now that there is, the beginning of an understanding that this is part of the scientific infrastructure and that it requires infrastructural sustained funding.
So that's kind of interesting. There are many, many different challenges in bioinformatics. And so you can think about the scientific challenges. There's actually very, these days, very simple mundane challenges about just the data volumes. And a lot of people, when they look at the data volumes, they wonder how you ever deal with them. In fact, I think the key thing is that those data volumes have moved from being trivial, that it sort of pre-2007, pre-2008, they were just trivial. And now you have to think about them, and now you have to really think about what you're doing.
I believe there are two major challenges. One is that we get even more and more diverse data, and that means we are getting more and more different user groups into the field, and we need to understand them and accommodate them. Then there's another area where a lot will happen, and that's around translation of the information we hold into the health systems. And that is a completely different beast of challenge, because that's more in depth, while the other thing is more in width. And where to put the balance in, where do you want to move? Do you want to put everything in one direction or in the other direction? How to balance this, that you get really the maximum benefit for as many people as possible?
I think we've made strong arguments about the societal benefit of this kind of research, the feed into medicine, the feed into human well-being, the feed into agriculture, the feed into crop protection, things like that. And I think in the current sort of financial climate, the mood of funders is to actually question science and look for justification in terms of societal benefit rather than just the sheer advancement of knowledge.
In general, a lot will grow together. We need to look more and more into combining certain pieces of information that we hold in our different databases in specialized portals suited for certain communities, or work with certain communities that we can deliver them certain bits and pieces out of our different databases that they can build tailored solutions for their scientific community.
I want us to be both part of the furniture of everyday life that every molecular biologist needs to use our resources, that they use them without worrying about them, without thinking necessarily too hard about them, that all of that's there. But also that there are pieces of science and pieces of areas where the EBI, the service team leaders and the research team leaders are absolutely part of transformational things as well as the routine. Transformational things in human health, in plant breeding, in other things. I think in all of these cases, we're going to be working with this broad scientific community. The EBI has a tremendous track record, which I am very proud of, that we work with communities. We're nearly always in a joint project with something. There's nearly always some other leading scientific group that is working with us in a particular area. That is absolutely how we should do this. There's a whole variety of reasons why, but It's absolutely the right way to do this, and I want to see that also continue in the future.
It seems crashingly obvious to me that the EMBL is exactly the right entity to be the host of the EBI, or the organization of which the EBI is part. It's a world-class research organization. It's got the right credentials to push the service activity to serve research well. It's European. It only makes sense to do this kind of work at a pan-European level. It's owned by its member states. The EBI belongs to Europe. And I think that sense of belonging to Europe is obviously beneficial. I think that it would be hard to imagine a better organization to run the EBI than EMBL, quite honestly.